quiet last time. So I remind you that we were talking about, in general, a process generically of the form 1, 2 into 3, 4. And on the left hand side, we have the variation in time, so in the absence of interactions, which are described by the right hand side. The left hand side just describes the fact that the number density of particle 1 stays constant if the right hand side is equal to 0, that is to say it scales inversely proportional to the volume, the comoving volume. Okay. Okay, so what about the right-hand side? Okay, the right-hand side, it describes a generic process. So I remind you that these integrals means the usual Lorentz invariant measure. Okay, and before I would write this in a somewhat different way, but let me remind you what this is. So first of all, I said that I write this formula in the approximation in which the phase space is not filled, in a sense that all these FIs are much smaller than unity, so that I can neglect, and this usually I'm not aware of cases in which you have to take this into account, but so in this limit, I can forget about the difference between bosons and fermions because the phase space is empty. So which kind of processes, which kind of effects I'm neglecting? I'm neglecting, for example, the fact that if the process generates fermions, of course, I should take into account that the phase space must be empty for the particles to, because I cannot put two fermions in the same state. And for bosons, this will generate an enhancement, which is called the Bose enhancement. But for all the purposes that we're going to discuss in this course, I'm always in the regime in which the phase space is empty for all the particles. I mean, empty, it's just not filled, so that I can forget about the distinction between bosons and fermions, and basically I am in the Boltzmann regime in which the distribution is just described by this formula, okay, which is the limit in which I neglect the plus or minus one at the denominator of the Fermi distribution and the Bose distribution. So this was, so if now you write this, you get this. Of course, the energy is conserved in that process, so this means that this exponential is in front of everything, and you are left with this parenthesis, which depends on the chemical potentials. So let me also write this parenthesis in another way. So you can also write that the density, the particle density of species I is given by okay, where this number, I mean, I'm just saying that given this formula, e to the mu over t is in front of the full distribution, so the number density of species I is the number density in the absence of chemical potential times this exponential in front. Okay, so this ni0 is given by the usual integral, so the number of internal degrees of freedom integral in d3p over 2 pi cube of the distribution e to the minus the energy as a function of momentum over t. Okay? Always in this Boltzmann approximation. And now you see that this parenthesis can also be written, so e to the mu over t is given basically by the ratio between ni and ni in the absence of chemical potential. So this parenthesis, e to the mu 3 plus mu 4 over t minus e to the minus to the mu 1 plus mu 2 over t, che can also be written as n3 times n4 over n3 0 n4 0 minus n1 n2 over n1 0 n2 0. Okay. So why this is relevant? Because you see there are various regimes. So in the regime in which imagine that this interaction that we are describing is very fast. What does it mean very fast? Well, it means that this number, this which defines the cross section, is very large. Okay. So this means that since the left hand side is small, so the left hand side is just the variation because the universe is expanding. So let's focus on the situation in which there is a reaction which is way faster than the expansion of the universe. So basically the left hand side is zero. Okay, so the number you are in a stationary state and you want n1 to be constant apart from the slow expansion of the universe. So the left hand side is zero. So since this is very large, the only way to make it zero, it means that this parenthesis must be zero, which means that this expression must be zero. Okay. So now maybe it's not very transparent, but we're going to see many cases of this equation. So the bottom line is that if a reaction of this sort is fast compared to the expansion of the universe, then this expression is equal to zero. Which also, I mean, you can write it in this form, or you can write it, which is the same thing, saying that mu3 plus mu4 is equal to mu1 plus mu2. Okay. We're going to see that, for example, this equation will appear in any form of equilibrium. For example, for nucleosynthesis, you will have a reaction which implies an equilibrium of this kind. Okay, let me rewrite now. Let me rewrite this formula in terms of the cross section, so that it's a bit more transparent. Where do I go? Let me go here. Okay, so I want to let me write and then I explain. So what I want to do is I want to rewrite this. So this is a close friend to the calculation of the cross section. Okay, so I just want to express the equation in terms of the cross section. And so the left hand side stays the same, and here. Again, when I put zero, it means the distribution when the chemical potential is equal to zero. So basically, this integral, this Boltzmann integral over phase space. Then there is this object, which I will define in a second, but it is, I can already say what it is the thermal average. Okay, so of course, we are talking about a distribution of incoming particles, so there is not the cross section in general will depend on the energy. So I have to define a proper average, which I will discuss. So this means the thermal average, so the average over the initial states of sigma, the cross section, times the velocity between the two particles, one and two, or three, four, if I'm looking at the reverse process. So now I will explain, and then there is this parenthesis which I can write it, as I said, as this. So now let me explain. Okay, now let me write what this is, and of course I should get the expression above. Yes, so sigma v is
So I'm averaging over the initial states, which are 1 and 2, and summing over the final states, which are 3 and 4. And then there is e to the minus e1 plus e2 over t times n squared. Okay. Yes, so maybe, sorry, I just want to, let me put a reminder here. I mean, I hope this rings a bell with your quantum theory courses. So you remember that the differential cross-section in the notation I'm using is 1 over, so if the particle 1 and 2 are the ones which are interacting, and then there is the product over all the final particles, so there is d3pf over 2ef times m squared times the delta function, the four-dimensional delta function of conservation moment. Okay. So, sorry, let me go step by step. So, first of all, this is the usual relation between the matrix element and the cross-section, so the differential cross-section. So you see what I did here. So I took basically this formula. So the velocity is upstairs, okay? And then I integrate over the final states, which are 3 and 4. Okay, so I erased, but this integral means exactly the integral in d3pf over 2ef. Okay, so I'm integrating over the final states. And now I'm also, and this is something that usually I don't do in if I don't have a thermal bath, I average over particle 1 and 2. So what does it mean, averaging? I integrate over the phase space, weighted by the Boltzmann distribution. Okay, so at a given temperature, the typical energy of these particles will be described by, so the very high energy compared to T will be disfavored, and so on and so forth. So I integrate over P1 and P2 with this Boltzmann weight, and then I divide by, so I want to average, not sum, so I have to divide by this, which is the normalization, okay? Okay, so again, I take this formula, I integrate over the final particles, and I average with the Boltzmann weight over the initial particles, and then I divide to make it normalized. So you see that now if you put this formula there, you exactly get this, okay? So this object in front is the one that cancels this denominator, and then you are left basically with these formulas, and this parenthesis is the one that is written in this form, as I just explained. Okay. So this is the formula that that we need. Okay. So any question about this? So now you can understand a bit better what do we mean by equilibrium, okay? So you see that if I'm looking at particle 1, so look at this term. So this is as dimension of, so sigma is dimension 1 over length squared, while this is dimension length squared. This has dimension 1 over length cube. So this object has the dimension of a rate, so 1 over time. Okay. So this is the object that it's a rate, let me call it gamma. So I can write it, I call it gamma. Okay. Gamma is n to 0 times sigma b. Okay. So what is this gamma? Well, if you are particle 1, okay, the product of the cross-section times the number density of target particles, so you are a particle 1, so you want to scatter on a particle 2, so the product product of the cross section times the velocity times the density of targets gives me the probability per unit time of doing the reaction 1, 2, in 2, 3, 4. Okay? So, you see that when this number, so this is again, it's a rate, gamma. So if this number is much bigger than H, which is the Hubble rate, okay, so this means that this derivative, which is of order H, is small compared to gamma. So I can take this to be zero, okay, and the only way to make it to satisfy the equation is that this parenthesis stays very close to zero, because the gamma is so big compared to the expansion of the universe that I have to remain close to equilibrium, and this is the equation for equilibrium. Of course, if on the other hand, gamma, and now we're going to make a few examples, so at a certain point, this number can drop below H because, for example, N2 0, which is the number density of particle 2, can become exponentially suppressed. For example, if you're talking about a particle with a given mass, when the temperature drops, N2 0 drops because it's very difficult to create in the plasma particles of species 2. So this number gets exponentially suppressed. Okay? So you understand that in this case, you at the beginning you may be in equilibrium, as I will explain in a second, and later you depart from equilibrium. Okay. So now basically what remains is that I will give a few examples in which these equations, this formalism, is applied, as I explained, as I already mentioned last time. Let me start with dark matter. Okay. So, any question about this? I start here. So, I keep a bit this because I'm not going to use the same equation. Okay. First example of this formalism. Again, we don't know what dark matter is made of, so there are various candidates. So this is not something that we know about our universe, it's a model. Okay. In particular, I will focus on WIMPs, as I will explain. But okay, first of all, the general formalism is quite general. So the idea is that I have a particle, X, which is stable, or with a lifetime which is much longer than the age of the universe, so it's almost stable, okay. Stable for our purposes. And this particle, the only way to disappear from the plasma is that this particle finds a companion, the antiparticle, which may be the same or a different particle, it does not matter. And it annihilates, so there is an equilibrium between particle and antiparticle annihilating in some standard model particle. Okay, you can think, I don't want to enter too much into details, this could be leptons or quarks, so it's some standard model particle. Okay. So the picture is that there is some particle which does not belong to the standard model, which is stable, interacts, and I mean, in the early universe, it is created, so you have the standard model and you are in equilibrium with this species, which cannot decay, but can annihilate to standard model particles. Okay. So let me also assume, which is very reasonable, that the particles of the standard model are in equilibrium. So for those, not only are in equilibrium, but I also not going to neglect the chemical potential, in a sense that I'm going to take for this particle the distribution N0. Okay, so these particles, they are continuously created and they are in equilibrium with the other standard model particles, so there is no departure of equilibrium of these particles. They stay at their fixed distribution, thermal distribution, which is given by this formula. I'm going to talk later about chemical potentials, but chemical potentials, anyway, it's at, okay, you have to check a posteriori, but we are at high temperatures, so the small difference between baryons and antibaryons is not relevant, as I will discuss later on. So you can forget about mu and take this to be at mu equal to zero. Okay, so the picture should be already clear. I mean, so what happens is the following. So now, this is the interaction 1, 2 into 3, 4 that I'm talking about. Okay, and what happens is again the following, that as I was mentioning, so you have a certain cross section, but the n to 0, which is in this case is the distribution of x, will be exponentially suppressed when the temperature reaches the mass of this particle. Just to give you an idea, I'm talking about particles of around 100 GeV mass, something on this order. So if we are at extremely high energy, as the temperature goes down, at a certain point, X will become exponentially suppressed. Now, what happens? So, in principle, if you go on following the Boltzmann suppression, you go, the particle annihilate, the temperature is too small for these particles to recreate X, because the temperature is dropping. If you keep on going with thermal equilibrium, at a certain point, the density of X goes exponentially to zero, okay, and there is no particle left. Okay. On the other hand, there is a limit to this process. So in principle, this could happen, but it happens if I have a situation in which there is no other time scale. If I wait long enough, eventually this will happen. On the other hand, we know that there is another time scale, which is the lifetime of the universe, the Hubble. Okay. So when this product drops below Hubble, this means that you say that particles freeze out, which means that at a certain point they cannot keep up anymore with the prescription of thermal equilibrium, so they depart from these formulas which describe thermal equilibrium. So, of course, this formula does not assume thermal equilibrium, so we can calculate what is called the relic abundance. Okay, so particles X go on annihilating until at a certain point they are so rare that they cannot find themselves anymore, and you are left with the residual abundance of this X particle. Since these particles are stable, they stay around. Okay. And since these are massive particles, they are good candidates for dark matter. Okay. Now, basically, the question I'm trying to address is that what kind of masses and interaction should this particle have in order to have a relic abundance, which is of the order of the observed dark matter abundance. Yes?
This relic abundance is just because we have a finite time for all x to find each other and annihilate, right?
Yes, in principle, yes.
And you said that they are like, again, they freeze out of the thermal equilibrium with other, like for this process, they. You consider them that they are not obeying the thermal distribution law.
Yes.
But in that formula,
yes,
we will use, it's not assuming that if it's something obeying the equilibrium or not. It's a general.
Thanks for asking, because it is what I want to point out. There are various aspects. So what I did here, you see, I tell you the short answer. The short answer is that there are two kinds of processes. So there are processes in which particles change nature, like this. And then there are also scatterings without the change of nature. So this particle X will go on scattering with electrons, with particles. I mean, we have very high energy. All the standard model is there. So there are two kinds of processes. There is this change of the number of axes,
And there are scatterings with the other standard model particles. Okay. The scatterings change the kinetic energy of this X and keep them in thermal equilibrium with the rest of the standard model. So, from the point of view of the distribution, this distribution, so again, you remember that when we derived the Fermi and Bose distribution, we are imposing the conservation of the energy and the conservation of the number of particles. So now, what happens is that, of course you should check this, but I tell you that it's true, that particles, so interactions which exchange energy between X and the rest of the world are fast enough that you remain with this Boltzmann distribution as a function of the energy. On the other hand, what we are discussing is the fact that the interactions which change the nature of particles will not be fast enough to keep equilibrium. So, to answer your question, here, actually, what I did, I always using this thermal distribution for all the species. So I'm already assuming something, which is the fact that the distribution of momenta is given by a Boltzmann distribution, but I'm playing with the number of particles. Okay. But again, this is not general, so this equation is not fully general. Of course, the general, in many cases, it is useful also to study, for example, even for this case, another question that I could try to address is at a certain point X will also will not be able even to keep change of energy with the standard model fast enough, so they will decouple also from this point of view. So usually in the literature sometimes you find these words, which are, one is chemical equilibrium. Well, chemical means this kind of means a change of species, while the other is a kinetic equilibrium, which means I'm still able to exchange kinetic energy with the rest of the particles. So usually these two things are different, and usually one particles can be chemically decoupled but still in a kinetic equilibrium, which means that they are still described by this distribution. At a certain point they will not be able to scatter anymore, and after that, of course, I cannot describe them with the thermal distribution, and they will play, they will just free stream, okay? They will not be described by any statistical distribution. Okay, yeah, so again, I'm talking only about this part of the story, assuming that this remains true for a longer time. Which is, for this particular case, is a very good approximation. Any other question? Okay, so let me use this formula for this particular case. I told you that the standard model particles, I assume that they are in equilibrium. So this means that for particle 3 and 4, this is 1, okay? So you see that bringing this inside, this becomes n10, n20, minus this, simplified with this, n1, n2. Okay. Let me write the formula. Is 1 over, I'm talking about the density of particle x. And that is sigma p. And then in parenthesis, nx0. Squared minus nx squared. Okay, let me do some manipulation. So first of all, of course, it does not make, imagine that you want to put it in Mathematica. Well, it does not make much sense to study nx, because nx, it goes down as 1 over a cube. So a quantity which is makes more sense to study is the ratio between nx and the temperature cube. Okay, so I define this new variable. Why? Well, because for example, at very high temperature, when everything is in equilibrium, this quantity is a constant. Okay, so at very high temperature, much higher than the mass, this, you remember that goes like t cube, so you approach a constant. Good. So, yeah, if you write this equation in this, you get dy in dt. So, I also remind you that the temperature goes like 1 over a cube. Now, we discussed that sometimes if there is a change in the number of degrees of freedom in the plasma, the change of G star, then it's not true that the temperature goes as like 1 over a cube. Since I'm going to study this equation only in a small range, so basically I'm interested in the regime in which this object becomes small, so it's a certain range of temperatures, so I'm going to assume that there is no change of G star in this region, so I'm going to assume that the temperature goes like 1 over A. Okay, so basically you see that this is using this approximation, this is a constant, so you get y, so dy and dt, and on the right hand side you get t cube sigma v times y0 squared minus y squared. Okay, so I just crazy. Then of course, what is the regime of temperatures we're interested in? Well, you see from the Boltzmann distribution that you will start having an exponential suppression when the temperature is of order of the mass of x. Okay. So instead of using the temperature as a variable, one can use a variable which I call x, which is just the ratio between the mass and the temperature. I expect that everything will happen when x is around unity, okay? Because this is the moment when the temperature is of order the mass. So I want to change the variable, so instead of using time, I want to use x. So the algebra is pretty simple, so dx in dt is equal to, by definition, is d in dt of m over t, and this becomes minus 1 over t, dt in dx times x. Okay, so, it's a simple algebra. Simple algebra if it's correct. Okay. So I just, the derivative of 1 over t is minus 1 over t squared. I put 1 over t outside and I use x again. Then let me also write this in terms of the Hubble parameter. So you see that the Hubble parameter is dA in dt over A. You see that this is the same because we said that the temperature is 1 over A, which gets this minus sign, so this is also Hx. Erase this. Good, so I have to put this change of variable here, okay, and let me rewrite. So again, I want to use everything around x equal to 1. So let me also tell you that Hubble is Hubble 1 over x squared, where Hubble 1, by definition, is the value of Hubble when x is equal to 1. So it is to say when the temperature is equal to the mass. Okay. The fact that it goes like x squared, well, X squared means like temperature squared. We are in radiation dominance, so in radiation dominance Hubble squared is the energy density. So Hubble squared is proportional to rho, which in radiation dominance, and we are, as I will see, we are way in radiation dominance, this is proportional to t to the fourth, which means that h is proportional to t squared. So this means that h is inversely proportional to x squared. So I write h equal to h at t equal to m over x squared. Good, so if you put everything, I just changing variables, so the bottom line is the following, the equation is dy in dx is equal to lambda, which I will define, over x squared, times y0 squared minus y squared, okay? So lambda is the equation now is universal, and everything is put into lambda, okay? Lambda contains everything evaluated at t equal to m. So lambda by definition is, if you put all these things, you have to follow the change of variables, it's m cube times sigma v over h1. Okay. So why this makes makes sense? So first of all, this object is dimensionless, because this is dimension length squared, so this is dimensionless. And this is similar to what I was describing before, because we are at the temperature of order m. So this m cube is also the order of the number density of targets. So it's m cube is t cube at when the temperature is m. So this is the number density. I told you that the number density of targets times the cross section times the velocity is the rate. So this is the same as the rate over h, okay, at t equal to m, okay? All right, so you see that the way this reaction works depends on the value of lambda. So if lambda is much bigger than 1, it means that when x is equal to 1, that is to say, when the temperature is of order the mass of the particle, the reaction is still very, very fast. This means that I will need to become very Boltzmann suppressed before I decouple. Okay? So this number is so big that I need this y0 to drop a lot exponentially until you lose chemical equilibrium. If on the other hand lambda is already of order unity, it's enough to go down a bit in the thermal suppression for the particle to go out of equilibrium. Okay, so the now I'm going to have an approximate solution, but you should think about the following, no? So we're talking about this variable y as a function of x. So x is 1 over t, so basically x is proportional to the scale factor, okay? So it's y as a function of the scale factor. Now, at very large temperature, which means at very small x, I am in chemical equilibrium, and this ratio, since I am at temperatures much higher than the mass, this ratio is of order unity, because it's basically a massless particle. You remember that the number density goes like t cube. Okay, so I start with the value of order unity, and then if I follow the Boltzmann distribution, when x becomes of order unity, I start becoming exponentially suppressed. Okay, so I will drop exponentially. Okay, so this is what happens in equilibrium. On the other hand, depending on the value of lambda, at a certain point I will not be able to keep the equilibrium and I will freeze out. Okay, so depending on the value, this will happen at different values of y. notice that the more sigma is large, so the larger is your interaction with the standard model, the more you go down in this curve. Okay, so if I take a particle which is weakly interacting with weakly, I mean in a generic sense, not weak interaction, but it's mildly interacting with the standard model, then it's enough to have a bit of suppression and you freeze out. If on the other hand you have a particle which is strongly interacting with the standard model, this process goes on even when this is suppressed, and you follow more this exponential suppression. So the relic density is inversely proportional, we see, inversely proportional to the cross section. Okay, so the any question?
So,
yeah.
Why is it necessary for x and delta x to have the same density?
The same density. Yes, it's a good question. You can also relax this. Actually, you can also. It's good question. It's a good point. So there are cases you can create some asymmetry. In the simplest picture, it's even like this, in a sense that x is its own antiparticle. So then everything can be, no, you're right. Everything can be more complicated. Here I'm assuming that either it has the same. Of course, notice the following. So if you want to create an asymmetry between x and x bar, it means that there must be some conserved quantum number, which, because otherwise there will be some interaction, so it could be. So if there is some conserved quantum number which distinguishes x and x bar, then it's possible that there is some asymmetry, like it happened in the standard model for baryons. Okay? Here I'm assuming that there is no, either they coincide, so the x is its own antiparticle, or there is no conserved quantum number, so that x and x bar they are the same. But it's possible to make things more complicated. Yes. So to answer a bit his question, what is nice about this picture, as it become I think more clear, is that you know there is not much. So everything is encoded in the mass and the cross section of this particle. So in a sense that assuming that there is no asymmetry, I start at in thermal equilibrium at very high energy, I just wait, and I'm left with a certain relic abundance, and I can ask whether this relic abundance is okay to the scalar matter. So there are a few parameters. Of course, you can always complicate things, but the nice thing about this is that there are not so many parameters. Any other question? Okay, now I'm going to, I mean, of course, this equation you can easily put it in Mathematica. Also, so I'm going to give some approximate solution. Okay, well, to get some. Notice also that I'm going to take this lambda to be a constant as a function of the temperature. Of course, this is not completely correct because here there is a thermal average. Okay, so the cross section in general will depend on the energy, and so things there will be some dependence on the temperature. On the other hand, you see the problem here. I mean, x appears exponentially, so. If x becomes 100, well, you don't have much of x left because they're suppressed by e to the minus 100. So x, and therefore the temperature, is around, I mean, at 1 there is no suppression. So it's between 10 and 50 or something like this. So there is a window, and okay, it's true that this cross-section may depend a bit on the energy, but as a first approximation, you can take lambda to be a constant. So the just to give you an idea, if the particle X, they have a mass of order 100 GeV, you have some suppression, so you are going to get a decoupling, depends a bit on the cross section, but around, say, 10 GeV, something like this. First of all, let me solve approximately. So it's an approximate, so I'm not going to capture the factor of order 1, but I will get the order of magnitude. So so let me concentrate on this region in which particles are already much more abundant than the thermal result. Okay. So if you are much more abundant than the exponentially suppressed curve, it means that y0 is much smaller, y0, which is this curve, is much smaller than the solution to the differential equation. Then I can neglect this. Of course, this is good only when I depart from thermal equilibrium. So in this limit, I get dy and dx is equal to approximately minus lambda y squared over x squared. Okay, this can be integrated, and it gives so I call infinity, well, very small temperatures. F is the moment of freeze out, which is basically is when this approximation is good, when y start becoming much bigger than y0. Okay. And this is equal to lambda over x result. Okay, so I move y squared here, I integrate, I get this. Then I get xf and x infinity, but x infinity is 0 because it corresponds to, the temperature becomes very small, so 1 over x becomes very small, so I can neglect it. So this, it's super approximated, this solution, but it captures, apart from factors of order unity, the result. Also, y infinity will be much smaller than yf, well, not maybe by orders of magnitude, but there is a difference. So I can even take the result that y infinity, the asymptotic y, the freeze out value, is of the order of lambda over x freeze out. Okay. So of course it's approximate, but it tells you one interesting result, that the residual abundance, as I was saying, is inversely proportional. It's proportional to lambda. What did I say? Sorry, I didn't invert it. I apologize. Okay. I do the inverse of this. So y infinity is of order xf over lambda. So it's inversely proportional to lambda. That is to say, it's inversely proportional to the cross section. This is exactly what I was explaining before. The more you are interacting, it's not completely intuitive, no? It should be intuitive. So the point is, the less you interact with the standard model, the more you are left, because it will be more difficult for the standard model particle to recreate you, and so you freeze out earlier and you are more abundant. So you are more abundant if you interact not much with the standard model. I don't know if it is intuitive or not. Okay. For example, just to, it will come as a next example, but another, you can really apply the same equations when you talk about bosons. So forget about dark matter. So, and I discussed the same things about baryon. Of course, for baryons there will be an asymmetry, but if you, for a second, you neglect this asymmetry and you assume that there is baryon antibaryon symmetry, then you have the same process. So baryon and antibaryons find themselves and annihilate. Now, since baryons they interact strongly, compared to dark matter as we discussed. So since I interact strongly, they are less abundant if there is no asymmetry compared to these dark matter particles. Okay. So I will come back to this in a second, but just to give you some. So here, these weakly interacting massive particles are they are only weakly. Now it means weakly in the sense of weak interactions interacting with the standard model. Okay. So they have a certain cross section which is much smaller compared to baryons, which are strongly interacting with the standard model. So the prediction of this is that if the relic abundance is fixed by the freeze out, the relic abundance of baryons should be much smaller than the one of these WIMPs. Okay. Good. Now, what is left? Well, now let's do some estimate. So the question is the following. What is the mass and the cross section that you need in order for this asymptotic relic abundance to be of the same size of the order of the measured dark matter abundance? Okay. Okay. I think I need only these of this equation, so x over lambda. So we said that y infinity is of order xf over lambda. And now let's put the numbers. So what I'm going to describe is what is called the WIMP miracle. For reason that will become clear. Okay. So what do we have to calculate? We have to calculate, first of all, the energy density of X particles today. Okay. Well, what is the energy density of these particles? Is the mass of these particles times the number density of particles today. But okay, the number density today is the number density at a given moment, which I call A1, so when the scale factor is equal to A1, times A1 over A0 cube. Okay, so A0 is today. I assume that A1 corresponds to when you reach this plateau. Okay, so after you reach the plateau, Nx goes like 1 over A cube. That's what it is. Okay, so but I want to write everything in terms of y. So let me do the following. So I write this as follows. So it's the mass. Instead of nx, I use y infinity, which is this variable. Y infinity is nx over t cube. So in order to do that, I have to multiply by t1 cube. Okay, and then there is A1 over A0 cube. Okay? So I just use the definition of y. Let me multiply and divide by T0 cube. Why I did this? Well, because you remember this object should be constant if there is no change of G star. Okay, so again, in the absence of change of the number of degrees of freedom, the temperature goes like 1 over the scale factor. Okay. Now, is it a good approximation? No. Because, I mean, we're talking about particles around 100 GeV, so they decouple at 10 GeV. Well, at 10 GeV there are many more particles compared to today, because basically there are a lot of particles on the standard model. Okay. So there is a change of G star, but you remember how to do it. So the message was that the entropy density is a constant. The entropy in a comoving volume is a constant. The entropy in a comoving volume is the number of degrees of freedom times the temperature cube times the scale factor cube. Okay, so this is the entropy in a comoving volume. So this object stays constant. So this means that if g star changes, this product does not stay constant, but okay,
you can calculate this ratio is equal to g star at the present temperature over g star at T1. Well, T1 is around this temperature, a bit below, when I reach the asymptotic value. Well, this ratio, I leave you to calculate, but is of order 1 over 30.
Okay. I mean, it depends a bit, because, you know, this can happen at different temperatures, so it's approximate, but of course, if you want to do things very carefully, you have to take into account that as this happens, particles go out of thermoequilibrium, all this, but approximately, it's a suppression of the order 1 over 30.
Very good. Okay, we almost have everything. So we come back to this formula. So rho x zero, the present energy density is 1/30, which comes from that. M y infinity t zero cube. So this is what the formula says. And y infinity is xf over lambda, which is given by this formula. So let me write what lambda is. Lambda is there. So this becomes 1/30. M xf t0 cube h1 over m cube sigma b. Okay, I just used this is 1/lambda written here. And this is that, so the mass goes away with 1 power of this, and we're left with this. Very good. Yes, what do I need? Well, I need what is H1? H1 is the value of the Hubble constant when the temperature is equal to the mass of the particle. So it's H when the temperature is equal to the mass. Okay, but we said that we are in radiation dominance, so you remember h squared is equal to the energy density over 3 m Planck squared. So then you put the expression for the energy density in radiation dominance, and you get approximately this. Okay, so you remember the energy density is pi squared over 30 g star t to the fourth. So this is the expression of rho in radiation dominance. So then to go to Hubble, I have to divide by 3 m plus squared. Then you take a square root, and you get this more or less. So I put g star over 10 because okay, approximately it's a reasonable number. All right, so we know what H1 is. Let me make a list. Now, okay, I'm not really interested in, it depends, but it's more useful to divide this energy density to the energy density, the total energy density today. Okay, because basically what we know is that nowadays dark matter is a sizable fraction of the total budget, is over 30%. Okay. So we want to divide by rho zero, the total rho zero, which is 3 m Planck squared h zero squared. Okay, so this is the Friedman equation. So the total energy is given by Hubble by this formula. So I'm interested in the ratio between the present density, energy density of x, and the total energy density, which is given by this. I mean, there's nothing deep, I'm just substituting all this. So I'm calculating omega x, which is the ratio between that and this. Okay, and you put everything together. and I get xf over 10 yes, now I put
so I did some playing with the pies and the tens. So of course all these estimates are correct up to all the unity, so I'm not super careful. Okay, so I plug these into these and then I divide it by this. Okay. Yes, one important point is the following, that the mass disappeared. Okay, you see that why it disappeared. So let's forget about this. So let's go back to this. So here there was m cube sigma v, which comes from the definition of lambda that I erased. M goes away with this. You are left with m squared. But h is Hubble when the temperature is equal to the mass. So it goes like m squared. Okay, so the mass, you see from here, h1 is proportional to m squared. So the mass cancel. Okay? So the final result only depends on the cross-section of this object. So this is, under the assumption that I was describing and with some approximation, is the formula that tells me the relic abundance of a stable particle as a function of a cross-section with the standard model. Okay? Everything is known, so this is the present value of Hubble, the present temperature of the CMB, and Planck. This is the number of degrees of freedom when this particle decouples. Okay, this is not completely known, but you know, under square root is not that you can screw up by a lot. Xf is x, which is this, when this particle freezes out. Well, it's of order, I don't know, 10, because okay, when the temperature is 10 times more than the mass, okay, maybe it becomes 50, but the ballpark is of order 10. Okay. Very good. So what is surprising about this formula is that if you put all the numbers in, well, you find, well, I mean, I can do it better. Yeah? So if you impose this number to be of order unity, say of order 0.3, which is the present contribution of dark matter to the energy budget, you find what sigma v need to be, and what you find is that that sigma v needs to be of order, say, 10 to minus 35 centimeter squared. Okay, there is an uncertainty in my order of magnitude, so it's not very precise, but what is remarkable is that this is not so far from a weak cross-section. Okay, so this is so if you do an estimate of a cross-section like GF Fermi squared times typical mass of order 100 GeV, what you find is something which is comparable to this. Notice that there is no information about weak interactions in this formula. So this formula has nothing about the standard model. It has the temperature of the CMB, Hubble today, and Planck, okay? But it predicts a value of a cross-section in order to have a correct relic abundance. This number turns out to be close, I mean, no, it's not super precise, but it turns out to be in the ballpark of a weak interaction. So an interaction of order 1 over 100 GeV squared, okay? This kind of cross-sections. So this is what is called the WIMP miracle. Now, whether this is an important hint or not, we don't know, but it's true that under the assumption that I was making, I didn't specify anything about this particle, I didn't specify anything of the standard model, but I just said that if you want the present dark matter to be the relic of some particle which is stable and decouple early on from the standard model, you need the cross-section which is of order with interactions. Okay. So apparently, since there is no indication of weak interaction in this formula, but it turns out to be of this ballpark, it looks like a miracle, a suggestion at least. Okay? So of course, I don't want to enter too much into details, but this has been taken for many years, in the last 30 years, as a strong indication that dark matter is made of these WIMPs. Of course, this indication was taken together with the fact that the hierarchy problem in the standard model was suggesting the presence of additional states around the weak scale. So the typical model people were playing with is some beyond the standard model model in which some extra state with mass of order 100 GeV is present, and this justifies dark matter and also maybe address the hierarchy problem in the standard model. So this was the slogan for many years. Now, is it still viable? I don't know. I mean, of course, so far nothing appeared at LSE. By the way, notice that everything is quite constrained because so what is very nice of this model is that what fixes this radical abundance is the cross section with the standard model. So it's not that. So of course there are rooms to play with the factors of two, but if this is the correct model, it means that there is a sizable cross section to create these particles at an accelerator, because an accelerator can do the opposite process. Of course, between theory and experiment, there are all the factors, and if this particle is 10 times heavier than expected, then it's maybe out of reach of LHC. So, there is a gray zone in which it's not very clear what happens. But, so people played in many ways. So basically this process go in accelerators, so you try to create this particle. So study. Another game that you can play is to look at this interaction look at the scattering between X and the standard model. Okay, so if there is some process, you can think about the Fermi interaction, so there are all possible interactions, so there is also the scattering of X with standard model particle. So how you can observe these kind of scatterings? Well, if X is the standard, is dark matter, it means that it fills the universe, in particular it fills our galaxy, and it's you can estimate how abundant is X in our galaxy. So if you have some detector, you will see that some energy is deposited because some X goes to the detector, leaves some energy on L, and you detect some energy coming out of nothing, coming out of the detector. Now, of course, this is called direct detection. These are all the experiments which are done underground, because of course the rate is small. It's not zero, but it's small. And of course, the experimental problem is that you have to distinguish this from some neutron coming from some radioactive decay in your lab, which creates some energy in your experiment. So it's very important to shield this from all possible contaminants. Okay. Now, also these experiments, again, there is also a target also in this, no? Apart from the usual factors of two, because, again, we're talking about weak cross-sections, so you have a scattering cross-section which is fixed by weak interactions. So far, all these experiments are covered a large part of the available parameter space, and nothing came out. The final possibility to detect dark matter if it is of this kind is to use what is called indirect detection. Which is the idea is the following. So these X particles are abundant in our universe. Okay, usually they cannot find each other and annihilate. This is the calculation that we did. But if you go in a region in which dark matter is very abundant, it's very is much more abundant than on average. For example, if you go at the center of the galaxy where the dark matter is much more abundant, then there this process can again happen because it's proportional to, I erased everything, but it's proportional to the density squared of these particles. So in regions in which dark matter is very abundant, you can have some annihilation into the standard model. And then what you expect is that these particles, say of 100 GeV, they annihilate and they create a standard model particles with quite high energy. Okay. So this is called indirect detection. Indirect because, again, you see some flash of standard model particles. Of course, here the game is that you have to distinguish this from all possible astrophysical processes. So it's a bit, again, this is a bit more model dependent, but people are playing with this. And also in this case, you can put constraints, but for the time being, there is no definite clear detection, of course. Okay, so these are the three methods. So I want to stress that these three methods are very robust in the sense that they are all based on the same process, the process that gives rise to the calculation. So this is what is nice about this model, that you have one interaction, and this interaction appears experimentally in many ways, and it's also the interaction that gives rise to the relic amount. So it's a very nice framework, but I don't know whether nature chose this to be dark matter or not. Any question?
What are candidate particles? What are the candidate particles that people think nowadays?
Well, the prototypical example is the one of supersymmetry. So notice that, I tell you the general scenario. I'm sure Goran can be much more precise, but so if you want to stabilize the hierarchy in the standard model, you need something to play a role around 100 GeV, 1 TeV. So you need extra states there. So the prototypical example is supersymmetry, but there are other examples. Now, this is not enough. Notice this is not enough because you also need a stable particle or almost stable particle. Okay, this particle is very long-lived, so more than the age of the universe. So you really need this, and this is an extra ingredient. Does not come from free. Okay. It's not completely it's not one-to-one with I solve the hierarchy problem, I get the matter. So it's much more indirect. But again, the typical example is supersymmetry. Which is the candidate? Well, the candidate is the lightest supersymmetric particle because all the others will decay, but the lightest, if you impose a certain symmetry, is stable, and depending on the model, this may be a different particle depending on the spectrum of supersymmetric particles.
Do they have to be elementary particles or like a proton that we never observed another kind?
The concept of elementary particle is a bit. We don't know what is elementary or not, no? So I don't know if the electron is elementary or not.
But not as a state of that hierarchical structure, but as a combination of...
Could be also a combination. In a sense, to the extent that it has the correct energy... if you are talking about the supersymmetric example, in most cases it's just one of the supersymmetric states. But, as you can imagine, you can complicate this model in all possible directions. So what I described is the simplest scenario, which is very nice because only the cross section appears on. Then you can complicate it in various ways. And I think in the last 5-10 years, people are sort of spreading in all possible directions, because you know this very simple scenario, and you don't see anything at LSC, you don't see anything in direct detection, you don't see anything in indirect detection. Now it's true that it could be that okay, it's a factor of 2 or 3 out of reach, but people spread in all possible directions, and which is okay. So I think 10 years ago this was much more mainstream. Now it's one of the possibility, but maybe not so fashionable anymore. I mean, yeah, this calculation is nice. I mean, it gives the correct relative balance, but... Any other question? One thing that I didn't say is the following, that you may have heard the concept of colder matter compared to hot or warm dark matter. So this refers to the following. So I explain what happens in this case and then I compare. So in this case, our calculation says the following, that this particle goes down the Boltzmann distribution, okay, and as I was discussing, I forget with whom, you keep on exchanging energy with the standard model, so you keep so the number goes down, but the distribution momentum remains the Boltzmann distribution. So since the temperature drops below the mass by this factor XF, which is of order 10 or order 20, something like this, it means that the temperature of these particles when they are released, when they freeze, is small compared to the mass, so they are more relativistic. Actually, the exchange of energy with the standard model will go on even further, and so the temperature will even go even lower than this calculation, because this was a chemical decoupling, while the other decoupling appears even at a smaller temperature. So the bottom line is that the prediction is that these particles are more relativistic when they decouple from the plasma, okay, and they have a very small velocity. So this is what is called cold dark matter. Now, why this is important? It's important because it's not part of this course, but as you can imagine, the way structure forms, meaning galaxies and all the structures that we see in the universe, depends on whether the particles move at relativistic velocities or are non-relativistic. Okay. Experimentally, we know since many years that dark matter must be cold. Of course, then you can quantify. For sure, it cannot be relativistic. It might be quite cold. So that is another reason why this kind of scenario is good. Okay. Because it describes something which loses temperature and becomes non-relativistic. Just to compare an example of hot dark matter. Well, neutrinos, okay, neutrinos, they have a small mass, we know. So at a certain point, they become, they represent some part of the dark matter, but they are relativistic. In the sense, we discussed, they decouple from the plasma at temperatures of order MeV, okay? So they are fully relativistic, and so, apart from the fact that they are not enough to represent dark matter, because their contribution is small, but they are not non-relativistic, they are hot, they are relativistic, and they cannot describe the formation of structure. People, of course, as always, they play in the... So, how cold it must be, there is this interface which is called warm dark matter, which means basically to study how experimentally how cold dark matter must be and what you can rule out if from observation if you have a model in which dark matter is not so not so slow. Okay. So this is okay. In the last unless there are questions. So in the last 5 minutes, I want to start, because it's very related to what I said, to talk about the next example of decoupling, which is the case of nucleosynthesis. But before discussing nucleosynthesis, I basically take the same calculation, but now I talk about baryons. Okay. So imagine that, which is not the case, that our universe has no asymmetry between baryons and antibaryons. So that this calculation applies. Okay, so as it was pointed out, I was assuming that there is no asymmetry between these particles, okay, because I took the same distribution. So let's do the same for baryons. Let's assume there is no asymmetry between baryons and antibaryons. So then what happens? Well, the universe cools down. Again, so baryons are at least the proton, the baryon with smaller mass is stable. Okay. So what happens is that these baryons find each other, they annihilate, okay, and you can do the same calculation as before. So at a certain point you reach a temperature of order the proton mass, then the proton start becoming Boltzmann suppressed because you cannot easily form it. Okay. So you go through it and it's really the same calculation. The only difference, so you can ask yourself, what is in this scenario the relic abundance of baryons and antibaryons, which is the same, in this universe which is symmetric? Well, it's the same calculation, it's exactly the same. The only difference is that the cross section is different. Notice that I told you that the mass disappears, so the mass does not play any role, but the cross section is very different. The cross section is orders of magnitude larger. Okay? So if you want, instead of 100 GV, the regime we are more like 100 MeV. So we are like 6 or 7 orders of magnitude difference. Okay? But I told you, if you have a larger cross section, then the residual abundance is much more suppressed. Okay? So the bottom line, there is an exercise that you're going to do, but anyway, it's the same thing, you just plug the numbers, and what you find is that in this universe, which is not ours, which is symmetric between baryons and antibaryons, the relic abundance of baryons and antibaryons is of order 10 to minus 11. Okay, so it's very, very small. Why? Because they annihilate going down the Boltzmann distribution a lot. Okay. So in this universe, you basically left with zero baryons. Okay? In our universe, baryons, you know, they represent, a fraction is like one over six of dark matter. Anyway, it's like 10% in this ballpark, a bit less. But it's not 10 to minus 11. Okay? So this very simple calculation, that's why I went to these details, because the same calculation can be applied to baryons. And the conclusion is that we do not live in a baryon symmetric universe, because in a baryon symmetric universe you are left with zero baryons and zero antibaryons, which is not what you observe, okay, by orders and orders of magnitude. Okay? So the bottom line is that as a starting point, there is evidence that our universe has an asymmetry between baryons and antibaryons. In the standard model, apart from anomalies, baryon number is conserved, so that if you don't want to go beyond the standard model, this is an initial condition for you. Baryon number is conserved, I decide that in a given comoving volume there is a certain number of baryons, which is slightly more than the number of antibaryons. Okay? Of course, as I mentioned, there are many theories that try to explain this number. Okay, of course, going beyond the standard model. Okay, these are all the theories of baryogenesis, so the way to explain why in our universe there are more baryons than antibaryons in the universe. Just, I'm not going to describe any. You can ask Connor. just let me tell you just a number. But no, everything is in the exercise, so it's okay. So, but okay, just to have some. So, and you want to know how much asymmetric it is, okay? And the number is very tiny, okay? So, if you go to high temperature, so you can calculate. So how to quantify the asymmetry? Well, for example, I could ask what is n baryon minus n antibaryons compared to T cube. In a sense that at high temperature, this number become is of order t cube apart from okay, so you can ask what is this. More precisely, as you are going to do it in the exercise, it's better not to use t cube but to use entropy density. Why? Well, because the entropy density is something which is goes like exactly like 1 over a cube. Okay. Anyway, this number is small, is of order 10 to minus 10. Okay, so this means, let me quantify, it means the following, that if you go to high temperatures, the universe is full of baryons and antibaryons because they are created by the interactions, but there is a tiny bit of more baryons and antibaryons, which at the beginning does not make any difference. That's why in these calculations I didn't tell you about, okay, there is a bit more baryon, because, you know, at temperature which are much bigger than the proton and neutron mass, I mean, this tiny difference of 1 to the minus 10 does not play any role. But as the universe cools down, instead of being exponentially suppressed and becoming extremely small, you are left with the residual, this residual difference makes a lot of difference, and you are left with only baryons, while antibaryons completely disappear from the plasma. Okay. Maybe I stop here. Yeah, any other question? Va bene, so we'll see tomorrow.